So this is lecture number 14 of this course on analog MOS circuit design. Now with the last few lectures I've been talking about a common source type of MOS amplifier in which case the input was applied at the gate terminal and the output is obtained at the drain terminal. Now in today's lecture I will talk about a different type of MOS amplifier in which case the input is applied at the source terminal and accordingly the output is obtained from the drain terminal. So to start with, let me just show you the circuit diagram. So we are interested in designing a MOS amplifier, and in this particular example we have taken NMOS with three terminals identified like this. This one is the gate, this one is the source, and this one being the drain. Now here we are applying the input at this particular node, source end, and we do have a drain resistor connected between the drain supply and the drain terminal of the MOS. So had this been the drain supply VDD and source resistor RD, then we are supposed to take the output from this particular terminal. And in order to ensure that the MOS is turned on, so we need to provide a sufficient amount of positive battery voltage at the gate terminal so that the channel is created and the device can turn on. So let's do like that. Let us assume that this voltage is equal to V1, and we have to ensure that this voltage should be greater than the threshold voltage so that MOS is turned on. And we have to also ensure that the MOS must be on in the saturation region, and under this condition we have to ensure this one to be greater than this condition is true for the MOS to be in the triode region. And this condition holds good for the MOS to be in the saturation region. So depending upon the relation between the overdrive voltage and the drain source voltage, the MOS can be on either in the triode region or in the saturation region. Now from our previous discussion, it is quite obvious that whenever we are trying to operate the MOS as an amplifier, so our emphasis will be to drive the device in the saturation region. So this condition must hold good. That means the gate source voltage minus the threshold voltage, which is nothing but the gate source overdrive, that should be less than the drain source voltage so that the device operates in the saturation region. Now before going into the detailed quantitative analysis of this particular circuit, let us now first have a qualitative discussion. So let us consider that the input signal Vin has been enhanced by an amount given by delta Vin. Then what happens to this output voltage? So initially we have some Vin, and then the Vin has been increased by some delta Vin. Let's assume we have a step kind of change, and that variation is represented by this one. Now here what you find, the gate potential is constant, VG, that is constant always, because a battery is connected at the gate terminal. So VG is always constant and the input signal is applied at the source. So VS is nothing but the input. And VD is nothing but the output. So if input voltage increases by some amount, then obviously this leads to the corresponding gate source voltage to reduce by the same amount because the gate potential is constant over here. So VGS will reduce by the same amount. And if I assume that the device operates in the saturation region, then obviously we know the relationship between ID and VGS, which is nothing but half mu n C aux W by L VGS minus VTH whole square. And if you'd like to include the channel length modulation, then this 1 plus lambda VTS term will also be there. So it's quite apparent that if VGS reduces by some amount, then it implies that the corresponding current which is flowing through the device will also reduce. That means the IDRT drop, the drop across the resistor, will also reduce. And from this particular circuit diagram, it is quite obvious that the output voltage is given by VDD minus ID times RT. So this output voltage is nothing but this voltage, supply voltage, minus the drop across this resistor. So therefore, if IDRT drops, it implies that V out will also increase by some amount. So ultimately, what we find is enhancement in the value of V in results in the enhancement in the value of V out. So without going into the detailed quantitative analysis, we can easily say that if there is a certain change in the input voltage in some particular direction, here it is in the positive direction, then the output voltage will also have a certain change in the same direction. Now that change is nothing but delta V out from here to here. And we are interested in finding out the voltage gain of that particular circuit by evaluating this particular factor, AV, which is nothing but delta V out upon delta V in. That we can do it quantitatively, and accordingly we can find out the exact value for the voltage gain of this particular structure. Now in order to do that, what we need to do is we need to draw the small signal model. Now here side by side I would like to draw the circuit itself as well as the corresponding small signal model so that it makes sense. So the circuit that we have drawn in the last slide looks something like that. We have a supply over here. The output is obtained from the drain terminal. Input is applied at the source. So first of all, we have to identify the three terminals of the MOS, gate, source and the drain. This one is a gate terminal, this one is a drain, and this one is a source terminal. And suppose this voltage difference between gate and source is given by V1, then obviously we have a voltage dependent current source whose value is given by Gm times V1, which is quite apparent. And we find that the gate terminal is held at a constant voltage, that is V1. So therefore, in the small signal equivalent circuit, this gate terminal is connected to AC ground. And we are going to apply the input signal at the source. So let's consider the input signal over here. We are applying over here at the source, V in. Okay. What is left? We have to connect this resistor RD. This is connected between drain to supply, power supply, and power supply is nothing but an AC ground in the small signal equivalent circuit. So ultimately, this is connected to AC ground like this. And we are supposed to take the output from this particular node, V out. So we are applying V in over here, and we are supposed to get output from this particular node. Now, if I just analyze the input side of this particular circuit, it's quite apparent that V1 is nothing but minus Vin. Because whenever I have drawn this particular small signal, the assumption is that this side is positive with respect to the ground. On the other hand, as far as the polarity of V1 is concerned, gate is considered to be at a higher potential with respect to source. So it's quite apparent that V1 is equal to minus Vin. And the current which is flowing through this is nothing but GMV1. Now if I consider the current which is flowing through the resistor RD, and if I call this current to be say small ID, then this small ID is nothing but Vout upon RD. And if I apply KCL at the drain end, then it says that GMV1 plus ID must be equal to 0 as far as their direction is concerned. So we can write ID is equal to minus GMV1, and which is equal to minus GM times minus Vin. That is equal to GM times Vin. So therefore, we can write from this expression Vout upon RD, which is the expression for ID, is nothing but GM times Vin, and which implies the voltage gain for this particular circuit is given by Vout upon Vin, that is equal to GM times RD. So we find an expression for the voltage gain which is almost similar what we obtained for a common source stage. For a common source stage with a very simplest architecture, we have found that the voltage gain was given by GM times RD, but with a negative sign outside. So if the gate voltage increases by some amount delta V in, then the drain voltage will drop down by some amount delta V out. So there was a phase difference between the input and the output. So that's why for a common source stage, we have a minus sign outside. But here for this particular topology, we find that there is no negative sign present. So gain is always positive. Now, if I closely observe this particular topology, in fact, the small signal part, we can see that the input is applied between the source and the ground, AC ground, and the output is obtained between the drain and the AC ground. And in this entire circuit, the gate terminal is always connected to AC ground because gate is connected to some constant potential, which is equivalent to AC ground. So we can also visualize that the input signal is connected between the source and the gate because gate is at AC ground, and the output is obtained between the drain and the gate. So therefore, gate is considered to be a common terminal to both the input as well as to the output. So that's why this particular topology is called a common gate topology or common gate configuration. Or in short, we can also write like CG. Now, this is all about the small signal model and the calculation of the voltage gain. And here we have explicitly assumed that the channel length modulation is absent. That's why the value of lambda is considered to be 0, or R0 is considered to be infinite. Now, if you'd like to include the channel length modulation, then obviously the circuit diagram will be modified, and accordingly with channel length modulation we have to include the R0 between the drain terminal and the source terminal, between these two end, and accordingly we have to calculate the value of the voltage gain. However, this is the maximum amount of voltage gain what we can have from a common gate MOS amplifier. If you'd like to include the effect of the channel length modulation by making R0 to be finitely large, in that case, you will find that the voltage gain will drop down from this highest possible value. Now, before progressing further, let me have a quick look on the input and the output impedance for this kind of circuit. Now, it is quite apparent that here we are not applying the input signal at the gate. Rather, we are applying the input signal at the source. Therefore, it is expected that the input impedance will not be infinitely large. So we will find out the input and the output resistance for this particular type of circuit with the corresponding notion as we have done previously. So let me draw the circuit once again. So that was the circuit that we're talking about. Now, in order to find out the input and output resistance, what we need to do in the first stage is that we have to make all the independent voltage and the current source to be inactive. So we need to kill those independent voltage and the current source, not the dependent one. So we have a three terminal device, gate, source, and the drain. And we have this voltage V1, which is connected between the gate and the ground, which is an independent one, independent voltage source. So we need to make it inactive. So that should be grounded. And let's assume that between these two terminal, the voltage difference is given by V1. And based on that, we have a voltage dependent current source, a dependent current source, whose value is given by GM times V1. And we have a resistor RD, which is connected between the drain and the AC ground, just like this. Then, if you'd like to calculate the input resistance, then you have to identify the input ports. So the input port is nothing but the source port here. So we need to apply a test voltage between the input port and the AC ground, and we need to find out the corresponding current being drawn by the circuit itself. So the idea is, here we have to connect a test voltage between the input node and the ground. Let it be Vx, and let the current being drawn is given by Ix. Then the input resistance as perceived by this particular test voltage is nothing but the ratio between Vx and Ix, something like that. So what we can find is, from this particular circuit, if I apply KVL in the input side, it says that Vx is equal to minus V1. And if I apply KCL at the source node, then it says that GM V1 plus Ix is equal to 0, which says that Ix is equal to minus GM V1, that is equal to GM Vx. So therefore, the input resistance as perceived is given by, let me just erase that part. Input resistance is given by Vx upon Ix, that is equal to 1 upon GM. And this value is typically pretty small, in the range of few tens of ohms or hundreds of ohms, not more than that. So unlike a common source amplifier, for which case the low frequency input impedance was infinite, input resistance was infinite, because we have connected the input signal at the gate, and eventually there is no current, no low frequency current will flow from the gate to the source. So that's why the input resistance for those particular topology was equal to infinite. But the case is completely different for this common gate topology, where we are applying the input signal at the source with respect to gate, and here we find that the input resistance has fallen from a very high value of few hundreds of mega ohms to few hundreds of ohms only. Because practically we can't say that the input impedance is going to be infinite. Practically the value is very large, and it can be like a few hundreds of mega ohms for a common source topology. Now here what we have done is, for a common source topology, we have connected the input at the gate and with respect to source. And for a common gate topology, we have applied the input at the source end with respect to gate. In fact, we have just exchanged the two terminals of the input signal between gate to source and source to gate. And we find here a significant reduction has taken place in the value of the input resistance, that is Rin. Now similarly, we can also find out the output resistance for this particular circuit. So we can similarly find out the output resistance, the idea being the same. Let me draw the circuit first. So gate is held at a constant potential, that is V0 or V1. We have a DC supply VDD, and output is obtained from the drain terminal, and we have applied the input at the source terminal. So once again, we have three different terminals, gate, source and drain. And gate is held at AC ground. Between gate to source, let us assume that the voltage is V1. And accordingly, we must have a voltage dependent current source between these two, which we identify by GMV1. Now, we need to observe the impact of RD, which is connected in between the drain and the AC ground. Now, what about this input voltage, this Vin? Remember last time we have connected the test voltage between the source end and AC ground in order to calculate the input resistance or input impedance. This time we are interested in calculating the output resistance. Now, in order to calculate the output resistance, the first step that we need to do is that we have to make all the independent voltage and current source inactive. Remember, in this particular circuit, let me just go back to the circuit. Now, in this particular circuit, we are supposed to connect some input voltage, some signal source at the source end, and we are sensing the output at the drain end. So eventually, we have not connected anything at the output node at the drain end. We have not connected anything. We have just measured the output voltage. We have just sensed the output voltage at this particular node. On the other hand, at the input side, we have explicitly connected some independent signal source, a small signal source. So while calculating the output resistance, we need to make that particular voltage source inactive. So how to make it inactive? How to kill this voltage source? We have to make it short circuit. So this terminal is connected to AC ground. And we have to identify the ports between which we are interested in finding out the output resistance. So here the output port is the drain end, and we have to connect one test voltage between the output node and the AC ground, just like this. So we are connecting the test voltage, let me call it Vx, between these two, and let the current being drawn by the circuit itself is given by Ix. Then accordingly, we have to find out what is the ratio between Vx and Ix, and that will give you the value of the output resistance for this particular topology. Now, if you just observe the input side of this particular circuit, you will find that between gate and source, this difference being zero, because both gate and source, they are connected to AC ground. But remember, this is only true whenever we are going to calculate the output resistance. Otherwise, if the gate source voltage difference is equal to zero, that means the input voltage is equal to zero, then you are not supposed to get any output voltage. But that is only true whenever you are going to calculate the output resistance. So we are making some special arrangement. We are making all the independent voltage and the current source inactive. And accordingly, for this special case, we find that V1 is equal to 0. That is only true for the calculation of output resistance, otherwise not. So for the calculation of the output resistance, we have to connect a test voltage between the drain terminal and the AC ground, and here you find that both gate and the source end are held at AC ground. So therefore V1 is equal to 0, and which implies GM V1 is also equal to 0. So if this is 0, then Vx is nothing but Ix times Rd, because the entire current will flow through this resistor Rd, since this one is absent, GM V1 is absent. So the R out, the output resistance, is given by Vx upon Ix, which is nothing but Rd. So now it's quite apparent that this particular value, the value of Rd as you have obtained over here for common gate topology, is almost the same what you have obtained for a simple common source stage. So if I consider a common source amplifier like this, where the input is applied at the gate, something like this, this was common gate, common source stage. The input is applied at the gate and output is sensed at the drain end. So this is common source. And here for the common drain, a common gate, what you have done is, so with this biasing, so we are applying the input at the source end and we are sensing the output at the drain end. So here we find that the input resistance for the low frequency of operation is infinite. However, for this particular case, the input resistance has fallen to 1 upon GM. However, as far as the output resistance of these two circuits are concerned, they are the same. In both of these two cases, we have obtained the output resistance to be Rd. Assuming that we have connected some explicit resistor between the drain and the power supply line. And we have also assumed that the channel length modulation is absent. That means lambda is equal to 0 or R0 is equal to infinite. Now with this assumption, we have ultimately reached to the conclusion that the input resistance has fallen from a very high value, a few hundreds of mega ohms, to 1 upon GM for a common gate topology. So this is common gate, whereas the output resistance is held at a almost same value. It was Rd for this particular topology. This is also Rd for this common gate topology. However, instead of using this simple discrete resistor, if you would like to include some current source kind of load or direct connected load, then obviously the output resistance will be different, and we have discussed all these things. But even if for a similar topology like this, where we have the drain resistor Rd in the form of discrete resistor connected between the drain terminal and the output terminal, drain terminal and the power supply line, and the input signal is applied at the gate for the common source, and the input signal is applied to the source for the common gate, we find that the output resistance being the almost same. And as far as the gain is concerned, we find that the peak value of the gain, if I just consider the magnitude wise they are same, that is GM times RT. However, for a common source stage, we have a negative sign outside. That means if the input signal increases by some amount, then the output signal will also increase, but in the opposite direction. That means here, if the input signal is having a fluctuation like this, then the output signal will having a fluctuation like this. On the other hand, for a common gate topology, both the input and the output will have a similar excursion. Now this is all about the simplest architecture for a common gate topology. However, sometimes in some of the complicated circuit, what you need to do is that we have to connect some bias resistor between the source terminal and the AC ground, which looks something like that. And moreover, the voltage V1, which is applied at the gate, is synthesized from the power supply line. That means we have already seen this circuit. And some V1 was applied at the gate terminal. Now, instead of applying a separate V1, what is done is the V1 is synthesized using a voltage divider formula by using some resistors. In fact, in the integrated circuit, modern integrated circuit, we don't use those resistors in the form of R1 and R2. We can also realize them using some other elements. And here we have another resistor so that the bias can flow through this, and the input signal is applied at the source end like this. And sometimes you can also include some internal resistance of the input signal like this. So this will give the complete structure of a common gate amplifier. Now, if this voltage is equal to V1, then we can easily synthesize this by means of R1 and R2 using this particular formula, as you know. And now, if you would like to calculate the voltage gain between Vin and Vout, then this voltage gain can be obtained by using a minimum trick over here, which is nothing but this Vout over Vin, which is nothing but the voltage gain for this particular circuit, that can be broken into two different components, Vx upon Vin multiplied with Vout upon Vx. Okay, so how to get this Vx upon Vin? So here you see that we have an input signal applied between the source and the AC ground with an internal resistance equal to Rin. And here the resistance, the bias resistor, the value is given by Rs. And apart from that, we have the input resistance offered by the MOS amplifier. And what is that? The input resistance offered by the MOS amplifier, just now we have calculated that value is given by 1 upon GM. And that is coming because of the MOS itself. So if I measure this voltage to be Vx, then it's quite obvious that Vx is given by a simple voltage divider rule, Rs parallel 1 upon Gm divided by Rin plus Rs parallel 1 upon Gm multiplied with Vin. Now with Rin is equal to 0, it's quite obvious that Vx equal to Vin. But if Rin is non-zero, Rin to be greater than 0, it's apparent that Vx is less than Vin. So a portion of the small signal will be lost because of the presence of non-ideal signal source for which the value of the input resistance or the internal resistance is greater than 0. Now, once you get this value, then we can easily calculate Vout upon Vx, which is nothing but Gm times Rt for a single stage common gate amplifier. So ultimately, the overall voltage gain AV can be written like we have Rs parallel 1 upon Gm divided by Rin plus Rs parallel 1 upon Gm multiplied with Gm times Rt. Now this entire calculation has been done with the assumption that lambda is equal to 0. That means the channel length modulation is absent. We have neglected the channel length modulation in this entire analysis. Now if you'd like to incorporate the channel length modulation, then obviously you cannot get rid of R0, because lambda is equal to 0 signifies R0 to be infinite. R0 to be infinite, because as you know, R0 is given by 1 upon lambda I d. Now in the entire analysis, we have got rid of the channel length modulation assuming R0 to be infinite, and ultimately we have obtained an expression of voltage gain like this. Now if you are trying to find out the value of the voltage gain with a non-zero value of lambda or non-infinite value of R0, then obviously we have to connect the resistance R0 between the drain and the source end, and accordingly we have to calculate the voltage gain. And it is quite obvious that if we try to incorporate the impact of the R0 or the channel length modulation, then the overall voltage gain will drop down from this particular value, and the expression of the voltage gain must also include the value of R0. But for the simple analysis in this particular lecture, we have just forget about the impact of R0, and accordingly we have calculated the expression for the voltage gain. Now with this, I would like to conclude this discussion on common gate amplifier.